good morning and happy Mother's Day to many of you who are here. We welcome you. It's good to be together to worship. Invite you to come on in out of the foyer as we begin to worship. Want to see the King. You know, sometimes we get really wrapped up on what's happening here on earth, but we're living for kingdom. We aren't just here we are passing through. This is not our eternal home. And so sometimes it's just good to remember that these things will pass away, but we're living for the heavenly.
No more crying there. We are going to see the King.
You may have a seat. On this day, we do come and we honor mothers. We say, we're so glad we've had moms that have loved us. We're often glad to be a mom. Sometimes we struggle with that. But you know, often in our Christian walk, we hold joy and pain at the same time. You know, this is a regular thing that we, as we're here on this earth, hold joy and we hold struggle together. And so I believe that our faith can encourage us. And you know, sometimes for those that have lost a mom this year, this is a tough day. For those who struggle with infertility or just have these aching arms to hold a baby, it's a tough day. At the same time, you know, it's great to get a little card on my counter in the morning, and it's great to get the hugs and the kisses. This morning, I think of my mom, and this year, in the last couple months, she's had a diagnosis that has sort of rattled us, and it's difficult, and she's dealing with pain, and it's really hard to see your mom in pain. It's hard to see a mom that hurts, and so I get that, and so we come together with all that, and we bring it to the cross. And this is where we come together as a church family, I believe, and encourage each other. So this morning, I want to read Psalm 23, very familiar, and let it be what it needs to be for you this morning. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not be in want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside quiet waters. He restores my soul. He guides me in paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup overflows. Surely goodness and love will follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. This week I read that psalm, and I read it in a different version. The New Living says, "The Lord is my shepherd. I have all that I need." Period. You know, I kind of stopped there. The Lord is my shepherd. I have all that I need. Sometimes we just need to stop there. As a bit of fun and humor and encouragement this morning, I do find interesting things on the internet. And so I want to read something that was an encouragement to me this week. And this is especially for moms who might be in the thick of it, who might be diapering and et cetera, or have been there. So just receive this morning. It says, let's encourage each other. So whether you breastfed or bottle fed, you are a good mom. Whether you had a home birth or a C-section, you are a good mom. Whether you push your child in a stroller or wear them in a wrap, you are a good mom. Whether you make homemade organic baby food or feed your toddler bottomless bowls of store-bought food, you're a good mom. Whether you homeschool or you walk your kids to a bus stop, you're a good mom. Whether you rub essential oils on them for fevers or you give them a dose of Tylenol, you're a good mom. Whether your home is perfectly clean or you struggle to even care about the dried toothpaste on the bathroom counter, you're a good mom. Whether you're planning a party this year or placing balloons on a headstone, you're a good mom. Whether you've had five healthy babies or lost babies before they were born, you are a mom, and you're a good one. We've all sacrificed to be sort of in this position of mom, and so we celebrate and want to encourage each other. So just receive that today and be encouraged in your momming. This morning, as we move to a time of prayer, just want to remember Scott Fenner. He continues to have physical challenges as he's recovering, and want to encourage you to pray for Scott. We also just want to take time this morning. If you have a prayer concern, just invite you to stand. And as we move to a time of prayer, those around you will just remember you with with prayer this morning. So if that's you this morning, I just invite you to stand and receive that. And those around you would just gather and put a hand on your shoulder. Okay. Let's just move to a time of prayer. God, this morning we especially thank you that we can come to this place of worship, that you have prepared ahead of us that we can come and worship you. We come as we are, and you receive us, and so we say thank you. You also say we will grow and we will serve you, and so we want to just walk in that. We want to be what you want us to be. We want to grow in knowledge and wisdom and to reach out. So would you help us here this morning? Would you help us learn ways to even be more faithful to what you have for us? Thank you for this body that gathers, that we worship you. We pray all these things in your precious name, Jesus. Amen. I invite Dwayne forward. He has a couple exciting announcements for you this morning.
Good morning. We have two announcements this morning. The first one is the Ivana Network survey that we've been talking about for several weeks. We're actually starting that today, and we'll be taking that survey for the next 2 weeks. It's a questionnaire about our faith journey, our church participation, our Christian beliefs, our faith practices, and what it's going to do. The information will come to Clinton Frame. We'll have that information. The other area churches that are part of Ivana will have the same information about their churches, and Ivana will be able to use that information to help us work together with those churches and to see how we can work together to help our community. So you will be, if you're in the church database or your email address is in the church directory, you'll be receiving an email this afternoon with a link to that survey. We have 2 weeks to complete it. There's also going to be a link on the church's website. And we passed out several paper surveys this morning to a few of the Sunday school classes where we know there are people who do not have internet access or computer access. If you happen to be one of those people and would rather fill out a survey on paper, they are at the information center. Pick one up, fill it out, bring it back, put it in the box within the next 2 weeks, and we'll enter it for you. It's completely anonymous. Don't put your name on it. And bring those back, and we'll take care of them for you in the church office. The second announcement, and this one is fun. When we finished our renovation, there are always what ifs and we wish we could have and things that weren't within the budget and within what we had resources to do. And two of those things were, we wish we could update our nurseries and we wish we could do something with our playground. We did this great thing in our children's area and now let's finish for our children as we get the resources. Well, our DOC class took on the nurseries. And if you haven't seen them, they've painted, redecorated, bought some new toys and things in there, and it looks great. So let's give our DOC class a hand for that. The other one, the playground. We had some funds left that were donated right at the end of the renovation that were designated for things that didn't fall within the project, but the We Wish things. We also received in January a very generous donation, give back from our construction company and the board, the pastoral team, the administration commission, discipling, all very quickly decided, let's put these funds together and we have enough to do the playground. So a small team was put together by Pastor Linda. They picked out playground equipment. We have volunteers who are going to do some excavating. And we're going to rebuild our playground with new equipment in the next few weeks. The children who are going to be using it are singing the offertory for us. Would you come forward right now? Let's line up here. And while they're coming forward, they've already seen this. They got a sneak peek. Jason, would you show us the renderings of the playground? So this is the equipment. This is the big pieces that you have coming. We also have someone from the congregation that is going to rework the swing sets for us. And by early June, we should have a brand new playground for them. Jason, next slide. May 21st is a work day where we're going to have one person here from the playground company to lead us in the build. We're going to be putting this whole thing together, pouring some cement in the holes, mixing cement, and we need your help. So if you're able to help on May 21st, please contact Pastor Linda, and let's have a work day and get this done for these kids. Kids, what do you think of this playground? Good? Okay. All right, I'd like the ushers to come forward, please, to collect the offering. Lord, we come to you this morning to thank you for the opportunities you've given us to take care of our children, to teach them, to raise them for you. We thank you for the resources you've given us to help us with that task. We pray that you'll be with us as we give this morning, that you'll bless this offering and direct it for your use. In Jesus' name, amen.
invite you to stand with us as we continue in song this morning, as we lift our voices, proclaiming who God is to us.
There's a love that came for us.
Battle in the grave.
present in our lives, interceding on our behalf.
But the whole is dead.
I needed a very wise, brilliant, deep thinker of a volunteer this morning. But Dan Bontrager decided to help me as well. So where's Dan at? He's probably not going to come up and help me now. Where'd he go? There he is. Come on up. I was just teasing you. I love Dan. My nickname for him, can I say that? Okay, he doesn't mind, is Beef. So if you just start calling him Beef Bontrager now, that's my special nickname for you. And there's a whole story behind that. But I need you to help me this morning. And you get your own little mic. Okay. So I'm going to ask you a series of questions. Deep, theological, philosophical questions. You're a pastor. This is right up your alley. So before I do that, I need to...
I have no idea what he's going to say.
Is that on? Are we good there? All right. So we have not worked on this beforehand. In fact, I asked you a couple minutes ago. So I need to plug something in here. Otherwise, it won't work. So I'm going to ask you some deep spiritual questions here. You ready for this?
I'm ready.
All right. Got to plug it in to make sure it works here. Okay, you ready? Question number one. What is that?
A toaster.
A toaster. And why do you think it is a toaster?
One, because it works.
You're sure it works?
Well, it's supposed to.
It's supposed to?
Yes.
Okay. Any other clues that give this away that this is a toaster?
Well, it has slots to put your bread in.
Okay.
And it has a lever to push it down.
Okay.
And it pops up when it's done.
Okay, so that's a good question. Like, what is... the purpose, this is the second deep question. Like, so question number one is, what is this? Question number two, like, what does this do?
It causes your bread to be toasted.
Causes your bread to be toasted. Now, I've got a piece of bread here. And some of you will notice this is my favorite type of bread. It's the end.
Really?
It is. So whenever I go to... To talk to the ladies in the kitchen. So Donna can tell you that's the bread I go after is the end pieces. So looking at this just a little bit, can you tell whether this is working or not? I can smell it.
It doesn't look red down the inside.
Okay.
But I can smell it.
I can feel a little heat coming off of it. So it has all of the signs that this is working. Okay. Obviously, I don't use a toaster a whole lot. Now, I have a question. The third question is, if this bread, if this toaster didn't toast the bread, would it still be a toaster? So that's that existential question, right? That question of existence. Like, it looks like a toaster. We know the purpose of a toaster. But pretend for a moment that it didn't work, that it didn't toast bread, that we would put bread in and it would just... kind of sit there and like, I'm not doing it. Would it still be a toaster if it didn't toast bread?
A non-working toaster.
A non-working toaster, all right. So it wasn't living up to its design, what it was designed to do.
Right.
Right. So we would have some questions about whether it was really a toaster or whether it was just like a fancy bread holder.
Yes.
All right. Thank you very much. That's the only questions I had for you this morning.
Oh, okay.
Excellent. Thank Dan a lot. Thank Beef. You know, my daughter, and I think we sold this at a garage sale a number of years ago. My daughter used to have one of those little play toasters in her kitchen. It didn't look anything near as fancy as this, little wooden toaster, but it looked, had all the external appearances of a toaster. It had the place where the bread went, even had two slots. It was a fancy one. Had a little button you could push down. It had all of the appearances of a toaster. But it didn't toast bread. It wasn't actually a toaster. When it comes to this toaster, its identity as a toaster informs us about its purpose. It was made, it was designed, it was created to toast bread. And we can get a little those questions about whether it's a toaster if it doesn't toast bread. For me, if it doesn't toast bread, it's not living up to what its inventor designed for it to do. Now, let's bring this into the spiritual realm for a moment. Let's bring this into our lives as Christians. Last week, we talked about identity. We talked about our identity as individuals and as a corporate body in Christ. Who we are adopted children of God. And that identity informs our purpose as believers. We weren't made to just sort of sit around for 80 years twiddling our thumbs, waiting for Jesus to come back, kind of every faithfully attending a worship service once a week. We were designed for more. We were created for more. We were created for a purpose. The question for us this morning is this: what is that purpose? What does that look like? How did God design us, create us to be and to do in this world? I think it'll be more than just toasting bread. So, if you have your Bibles, turn with me to the book of Ephesians. Ephesians chapter 2. And we'll actually be starting in verse 1 and going from there. So, Ephesians chapter 2, and we'll be starting in verse 1. We're going to answer the question this morning in a little bit. What is the meaning of life? Why am I here? Why did God create me? Ephesians chapter 2, verse 1. As for you, you were dead in your transgressions and sins, in which you used to live when you followed the ways of this world and the ruler of the kingdom of the air, the spirit who is now at work in those who are disobedient. All of us also lived among them at one time, gratifying the cravings of our flesh and following its desires and thoughts. Like the rest of the world, we were by nature deserving of wrath. So Paul, in understanding the current condition of things, of some people, he said, listen, all of us, Jew, Gentile, rich, poor, black, white, doesn't matter, male, female, all of us were dead in transgressions and sin. I like the one commentator says, we were completely unable to come to God on our own. We couldn't do it. In fact, in the early church, there was actually a theologian. The church later deemed him a heretic, someone who was a false teacher, who said, we are not so sinful, we are not so dead that we can't come to God, that we can't choose God ourselves. He said, listen, your good works, you can make that choice, you can come to God. And the church is like, no. Paul says it, we are dead, incapable of simply choosing to do good. We cannot choose life. And the early church began to talk about how God has broken through to us. It is God who takes the initiative to rescue and to redeem and to save. John Wesley had a term for this. It's called prevenient grace. Prevenient, before salvation, grace. Those moments in our lives where God speaks to us, that God breaks through to us, that God comes down to us and begins to prepare our hearts and minds for those moments, for that moment when we will choose Him, when we will come to faith. But it takes God breaking through that sin. It is God who makes us alive. Paul says, listen, all of us were dead. But then, in the most beautiful word, one of the most beautiful words in Scripture, the word but. And Paul uses it to transition to something else. So, starting in verse 4, but. So, this is the way you were, but something happened. But because of His great love for us, God, who is rich in mercy, made us alive with Christ, even when we were dead in transgressions. It is by grace you have been saved. And God raised us up with Christ and seated us with him in the heavenly realms in Christ Jesus, in order that we, in the coming ages, we might show the incomparable riches of his grace expressed in his kindness to us in Christ Jesus. And now one of the most famous couple of verses in all of Scripture. For it is by grace you have been saved through faith. And this is not from yourselves, it is a gift, the gift of God, not by works, so that no one can boast. How are we made alive? Is it through our own good works? Paul says, no. You can't do it. It all happens in Christ. In fact, one of the words, one of the phrases in here is in Christ, by faith in Christ. Another way of rendering that same little sentence is through the faithfulness of Jesus Christ. In other words, because of what Christ did, because he went to the cross, then we can be saved by grace. It is only because of what God has done in Christ that we can be what? What does he say? Made alive. We can come up from the dead. The other thing he says is this: we are raised up. We are not left in the tomb. We are raised up, seated with him in the heavenly realms. I think so often we hear in our culture this: as long as my good outweighs my bad, I'll get to heaven. Have we all heard that? As long as I'm a good enough person, as long as I do enough good and that good outweighs the bad, I'm good. I'll skate into heaven. I'll meet Peter at the pearly gates and it'll all be good. That decision is somehow some cosmic scale. Paul flatly rejects that. He says, no. You see, if you could earn your salvation, if you could just do enough good to earn your salvation, then Christ's death on the cross was meaningless. Christ didn't have to come and die because you could have done it all yourself. That's what Pelagius taught. You could do it all yourself. You could come to God yourself. And Paul says, no. You were dead. The only way you are made alive is through faith in Jesus Christ, through his faithfulness on the cross. So often, as we begin to move into this final verse, verse 10, is a verse that I want to really aim at, the focus on, to bring out this morning. Verses 8 and 9 are so popular in our culture, in our world. It's by grace that we are saved. Through faith. And so often we hear these debates about how Paul is all about grace. And if we look at the book of James, it's all about works. And well, is it through works or through by faith? And what are the means of salvation? And people bring James and Paul together as if they're opposites. And they're not. They work together. We are saved. And James would say this as well. We are saved by faith. By grace. But that's not the end of the story. There's something that we are to be doing. And we, when we add verse 10 into this, we see purpose. We see our identity, that we are adopted children by grace, by faith. Verse 10, though, says this. So all of this, we're saved by grace, not by works, so that no one can boast. For we are God's handiwork. And we brought this up a couple weeks ago when we read through the book of Ephesians. The word there is poema. Some of your translations might say masterpiece. The word is the word that we derive the word poem from. So we are God's poetry. We are God's poem. We are God's work of art, created in Christ Jesus to do good works, which God prepared in advance for us to do. So Paul and James would both say, yes, salvation by faith, by grace. It's nothing we've done. It's nothing that we can work for. But that doesn't mean that we just sit around for the next 80 years of our life, however long that we would be blessed with life, twiddling our thumbs, saying it's by grace, and all I have to do is sit here. No, like that toaster, our identity informs our purpose. He says, you've been saved by grace through faith in Jesus Christ because of what Jesus Christ has done. And because of that, God has given you purpose. He has given you meaning. He has given you good works to do, which he's prepared in advance for you to do. There's no conflict between grace and Paul. Let me use Israel as an example, because Paul continually draws on these Old Testament themes of God's covenantal relationship with the people of Israel. Was Israel rescued and redeemed first, or were they given the law first? What happens is that God brings them out of Egypt. He rescues them. Not because of Israel was fantastic, or they were the best or the smartest or the strongest, whatever it was. It was all God choosing them. And he brings them out. He saves them by grace. He redeems them. He rescues them. And then he asks a question of them. All right, I've done all this. You're rescued. You're redeemed. You're not going back. Here's my question for you. Will you be my people? Can I be your God? Will I be your God, and will you be my people? Now this will have demands upon you. So here are the options. Like, number one, if you choose to go your own way, that's fine. You can do that. You'll be protecting yourself. But if you choose to be my people, I will protect you. You will be my own. You will be my inheritance. You will do those things that I have prepared in advance for you to do, people of Israel. And all of Israel is like, yeah, you'll be our God. We'll be faithful. We'll be obedient. We'll do what you want us to do. And it was only then, after God had already rescued and redeemed them, that God says, all right, if you want to be my people in this world, this is how you do it. I'm calling you to be light and life. To put it in Matthew's terms, to be a city on a hill, to be salt for this world, to be light for this world. You're to be a beacon pointing people to me in this world, and this is how you do that. And so when you begin to read those laws that, you know, in Leviticus as we read, you're like, okay, yeah, mold. Yeah. All these rules and regulations. Again, those were life-giving things that spoke purpose and meaning into the people of Israel. This is how we are to be salt and light for God in this world. Saved by grace, but redeemed for a purpose, to serve God, to do what God has asked us to do. Their identity as adopted children filled their lives with purpose. As believers, and Joel will get into this next week, and really throughout the rest of Ephesians, read the book of James. God has those good works for us to do that he's given authors to write about. Like, this is how you be my people in the world. This is how you be my special nation, my holy nation, a kingdom of priests. This is how you be the church in this world. There's a way that you're to be living your life as my people, doing these good works. We're called to live holy lives. Lives of purpose. We're called to a purpose, and that we are to be going out into the world making disciples of all nations. every tribe, every ethnicity, every people group. Disciples of all nations. Those are the ones that we hear spoken about so often in our churches. It's the third one that I want to tell some stories about this morning. We are to be a kingdom people. See, I talked about, you know, we're not here to sit around on our couches and wait for glory. We're to be doing something, living out the values of the kingdom through doing good. Tell you a couple stories this morning. The first story, I need to make sure I have her name right. Tamar Manasseh. Young mother living in Englewood, California, one of the most dangerous areas of Englewood, California. Tons of gang violence. Tons of retribution, vengeance killings. In other words, you've done something to someone I love, so I'm going to go to your neighborhood and do something to you. And there's this back and forth in this small little neighborhood. And after one particular funeral, Tamar says, enough. Like, we have to do something about this. She saw the injustice. She saw the murder. She saw the death. And said, I must do something. So she organizes this march, and the group is called the Army of Moms. And what they do is whenever there's a vengeance, whenever there's a murder, whenever there's someone dies, is murdered, this army of moms goes to the streets. And they began to patrol the streets. See, mothers are so respected that no one would dare commit an act of vengeance in their neighborhood, in their community, because the eyes of mothers are watching. And she's raised up this army of moms to be a kingdom people in that community, working to bring healing and hope, to put an end to injustice. There's another mother, seems so appropriate on Mother's Day, living in Alaska. She has three kids of her own, and it becomes remarried, and her husband says, I would like to have three kids with you myself. And sure enough, she does. She has a healthy son and a healthy daughter, and the third one, she's been having some problems conceiving the third child, having some miscarriages. She's been praying, hoping, longing for a child that is alive. That child comes, and the child is born with Down syndrome. She rejoices with a live child, but begins to go through all of the struggles of what does it mean to have a child with Down syndrome. Now, this is 25, 30 years ago. There's not the same type of helps that there are now. In fact, many of the options were simply give it up to an institution. Give it up for an adoption. Give the child up for adoption. She chooses a different path. She decides to adopt a second child with Down syndrome. So she has five, she has a child with Down syndrome, now she adopts a seventh child with Down syndrome. Why? So that her child with Down syndrome has someone to relate to, who goes through all of the same things that they do. Now eventually she moves, and there's a whole other story here, she moves to Israel. And she finds out that there too is a growing institution of children who've been given up to adoption simply because they have Down syndrome. And she hears of one child at the hospital who was just given up for adoption. She goes to the hospital and she ends up adopting this child as well. She knows the child's needs, and instead of going to this institution that wouldn't really love this child as much as she would, she adopts it. She takes it in. Soon, within the next year, there's another child at the hospital who's been given up for adoption because it has he or she has Down syndrome. Lots of health problems, and she's in the hospital going to adopt this fourth Down children's baby. And she sees another Down syndrome baby. Now, at this point, she says, okay, I know that that's too much, right? Maybe many of for us, it would have been much before that. But I know that was too much. And so she goes to her neighbors and begins to advocate on behalf of this child. And slowly what begins to happen is the neighbors adopt this child. And every child born with Down syndrome is adopted in this community, in this neighborhood. And now all over Israel, people are sending letters adopting Down children, Down syndrome babies because of a movement, because of an advocation of this mother on the part of these children, bringing the kingdom through acts of healing and hope. Now, we've been called to a purpose. And you hear those stories, and maybe you say to yourself, like, those are too much. Like, I can't do. Just this morning, as I was trolling around YouTube, on Facebook, whatever it was, there was a story about this man. I don't know anything about him, but he did that. He collects crayons, and he melts them all down, and he's created this system to create new crayons with the melted wax. And he's raised up this army of volunteers who helps him sort everything. And he creates these crayons. And he gives them to children's hospitals. And they were interviewing some of the children who received these crayons. And they were talking about how they are blessed to be able to express themselves. Because they have these crayons that they didn't have before. So often we think we have to do grand, big things for the kingdom. And I think a bigger part is this: to look at the world around us and to look at the things that break our hearts. The things that we say to ourselves, this is not right. I must bring heaven to this place. I must bring heaven to earth. I must work with a purpose in this area to bring more of God. To be an agent of God's healing and hope in Christ Jesus. To proclaim the kingdom, to proclaim Jesus through that good work. What are the areas in your life of brokenness, of hurt, that you simply say, this is unacceptable to me? What are the areas that God has specifically gifted and called you? Maybe it's through some special gift that you have. Maybe it's through an experience that you have of tragedy, of joy, that God can use you to be a kingdom presence in another place. I've been excited about some of the different ways that people in this community have done similar things. I could go down through a whole list of things. But maybe you're someone who has been in prison or worked with prisoners, and your act of bringing healing and hope is to go to prisons and to proclaim the kingdom through love and service. As a Mother's Day, maybe you've suffered a miscarriage, and maybe your act of bringing healing and hope to this world is to work with an organization or these moms to bring healing and hope and restoration to them. Maybe it's to mentor young children through something like the Boys and Girls Club. What are the ways in your life, in your sphere of influence, that you can work to make a kingdom difference, to proclaim Christ to the world around you. God has saved you by his grace. He has given you a new identity. And he's given you a purpose in Christ Jesus to do good works, to be a kingdom people in a world of healing and hope. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we are so grateful that we are your children. Not because of anything that we've done, because, Father, we couldn't have done it ourselves. But, Father, we are your children because of what you have done in Christ Jesus, through the faithfulness of Christ. You have rescued us. You have redeemed us. And that choice to choose us as your church is for a purpose, that we would live out the values and the principles and the life of the kingdom in this world in the here and now. Father God, I pray right now that you would begin to look or begin to speak to us. Help us to begin to look at ourselves and our surroundings. Help us to be able to look in the places that you've placed us. Help us to understand the ways that we've been gifted, the stories and the experiences that we have, that by your strength and through the infilling of your Holy Spirit, that we will have the power to bring heaven to earth, to make a difference. As your people, may you give us eyes to see what you are calling for us to do, and may we be obedient to that call. And we ask this in the name of Jesus. Amen. We've been talking about those kingdom principles. That's our goal. That's our prayer. Build your kingdom here. And may we be the agents of your kingdom in the here and now. Following this song, this response on our part, we're going to have people up here who are willing to pray for you. Perhaps you want to say, like, God, give me wisdom. And you want someone to pray with, to pray that blessing upon you. Perhaps it's something that you're struggling with this week. Perhaps it's a healing, a hurt in your life, and you need to release that to God. You need to allow someone else to be an agent of healing and hope to your life. We invite you to come forward after this song, after the service, to accept prayer. Will you rise as we sing this anthem? God, may your kingdom be built here, and may we be your agents to bring that to fruition.
Unveil a flower made.
God's kingdom agents in this world to bring healing and hope. And we do it not out of obligation, but out of gratitude for what God has done in Christ Jesus for us. May you go out and be a presence of healing and hope around you.